Am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So first of all, I would like to thank Professor Sugma for such a nice introduction. And Honorable Principal C. Abdul Hakim College, Professor S. A. Sajid, convener of the webinar, Professor Sheikh Mohammad Rafi, organizing secretaries, Professor Sugma and Professor Mukhtar, other faculties and dear participants. A very good afternoon and a very warm welcome to all of you. At the outset, I would like to thank the organizing committee of the webinar for providing me this opportunity to present on this platform. So myself, Dr. Rajesh, an assistant professor in Ramanujan College, University of Delhi. Okay, so the title of my talk is Domination and Independent Domination in Graphs. So the notion of domination has a rich historical background and it has attracted a lot of researchers over the years due to its wide range of applicability. The concept of domination was first formally introduced by Orr in 1962. The theory of domination has found its application in almost every branch of science. It is used as a tool to solve various problems arising in biological networks, communication and computer networks, social networks, and many other networks. The concept of domination is also used to study various numerous facility location problems. Like if you want to locate some radar station, or if you want to locate some nuclear power station, hospitals, fire stations, or many other resources. So since the resources are limited and we have to maximize the number of people that can get benefit from these resources, so we can use this domination theory to maximize the benefit. And there are more than 80 different types of domination that has been defined and is being studied so far. Professor Mohammed Ismail, who is the resource person for tomorrow, so most probably he will be discussing on these variants and their application. So in this talk, I will talk on the equality of two graph theoretic parameters which are based on domination, which is domination number of a graph and independent domination number of a graph. So what is a dominating domination? What is domination in graphs? So given any graph G, a subset D of the vertex set VG will be called a dominating set if every vertex outside D is adjacent to some vertex in D. And we say that every vertex outside D is being dominated by some vertex in D. And the domination number is the minimum cardinality of a dominating set in G. So it is denoted by the parameter gamma G. So gamma G is the minimum of all cardinalities where D is a dominating set of G. And a set with cardinality gamma G is called a gamma G set of G. So here is an example. So in this example, I have a graph. So in this graph, I have partitioned my vertex set into two sets, D and V minus D. Here, if you can see, any vertex in D is either adjacent to 0 or it is adjacent to 1. So basically, D satisfies the definition of a dominating set. So it is a dominating set. And if you can see, there are no other vertex which dominates all the other vertices of the graph. So domination number of this graph is equal to 2. So these are two books, the very fundamental books on domination. Anybody who wants to pursue research in domination must have this book and must study at least some of the chapters of this book to start their research in domination theory. So the notion of domination is believed to be originated in 1850s from the famous chessboard problem. So what is the chessboard problem? It is to find the minimum number of queens that we can place on an n cross n chessboard such that every square on the chessboard is either occupied by one of the queens or is attacked by one of these queens. So what basically is this problem is that you are given a chessboard, suppose you are given an 8 cross 8 chessboard and you are given some queens and you have been asked to place these queens on the chessboard and you have to choose the minimum number of queens. So you have to place the minimum number of queens on the chessboard such that each square of the chessboard is attackable by those queens. So first we have to understand how a queen attacks on the chessboard. So a queen can attack on the chessboard horizontally, vertically, or diagonally. So how we represent this problem into a graph theoretic problem? So let us represent this problem. So what we do is we take the chess squares of the chessboard as the vertices of the graph. So what we do, we take, so suppose we have an 8x8 chessboard. So there are 64 squares. So we represent each of these 64 squares by a vertex. And then because our queen moves vertically, horizontally, or diagonally, so what we do, we make any two vertices of this graph adjacent if they lie on the same row, diagonal, or same column. So the graph that we obtain is called the queen's graph. So basically, our queen's graph is a graph of order n square because it is on n cross n chessboard. So it is a graph of order n square, and we make two vertices adjacent if they are in the same row, column, or diagonal. So with this representation, the problem of finding the minimum number of queens on the chessboard says that every square of the chessboard is either occupied by some queen or is attacked by one of the queens is equivalent to finding a dominating set of minimum size in the graph corresponding to the chessboard. Thus, the chessboard problem amounts to finding the domination number of the queen's graph Qn. So here is an example. So I have illustrated with a 3x3 chessboard. So on the left, I have a 3x3 chessboard. So there are 9 squares on it. And on the right, I have represented a graph corresponding to this chessboard. So each of these squares are represented by the vertices. And I have made two vertices adjacent if the corresponding squares are on the same row, same column, or same diagonal. So this is the graph that we obtain. So this is the queen's graph Q3. And if you can look, the vertex 1 and vertex 6, they dominate all the other vertex of this graph. And if you look at this graph further, then you will find that there is no vertex which can dominate all the other vertices. So its domination number has to be equal to 2 because its domination number cannot be equal to 1. So the answer to this chessboard problem when we take n equal to 3 is 2. This problem, the 8x8 chessboard problem, this has led to the origin of domination, and it later on by I think Birch, it was proved that the domination number for queen's graph when n is equal to 5, n is equal to 8 is 5. And this is the solution. So if you can place your queens at these places, then all the other squares are attackable by these queens. Now, in this table, I have represented the domination number of queens graph for various values of n. So as you can see, if when we take a 1x1 chessboard, then its domination number is 1. For 2x2 and 3x3 also, the domination number is 1. For 4x4 chessboard, the domination number is 2. Then for 5x5 and 6x6, the domination number is 3. For 7x7, it is 4. For 8x8, it is 5. For 9x9 and 10x10, 11x11 also, it is 5. Then for 12x12, it is 6. For 13x13, it is 7. For n equal to 14, it is 8. For n equal to 15, 16 and 17. 17 and 18, it is 9, and then for n equal to 19, it is 10. So for large values of n, you have to use the computer algorithms to generate these values because it is not easy to find the domination number using your pen and pencil. So you have to write computer algorithms to generate these domination numbers. So anybody who is interested in, because this is a very good area of research, so anybody who wants to find domination number of queen's graph and who is good in computer algorithms, he can take this problem and it will be a very good publication. Now we come to independent domination. So what is an independent dominating set? Again, in any given graph G, a subset D of the vertex set will be an independent dominating set if it is first dominating and it is independent. So if it is dominating and independent, then it is called an independent dominating set. And the independent domination number is the minimum cardinality of an independent dominating set in G. So independent domination number is basically minimum of cardinality of D, where D is an independent dominating set of G. And an independent dominating set with cardinality IG is called an IG set of G. Now, by definition, if you can see that any independent dominating set, by definition, it is a dominating set. So every independent dominating set is a dominating set, and therefore the set of all independent dominating sets will be a subset of the set of all dominating sets, and hence the domination number will always be less than equal to the independent domination number. That is, our gamma G is always less than equal to IG. So here are two graphs. So in the graph G1, I have given a graph G1 in which domination number gamma G1 is equal to independent domination number. So as you can see, in this case, the vertex 1 and 2, it dominates all the vertices of this graph, and 1 and 2 are independent as well. So D is both gamma G1 set as well as IG1 set. That is, D is both dominating set as well as independent dominating set. So for this graph, gamma G is equal to IG is equal to 2. Now for the graph G2, this is a example of a graph in which domination number is strictly less than the independent domination number. And as you can see, the vertex 0, 1, 2, it dominates all the vertices of this graph. So it is a dominating set, but it is clearly evident that it is not independent. So for independence, we have this 0, 5, 6, and 7. So these vertices, they dominate and they are independent as well. So for this graph, gamma G is equal to 3 and IG is equal to 4. So here is a table for comparison between domination number and independent domination number in case of Coons graph. So for chessboard, for n equal to 1, 2, and 3. Domination number is equal to independent domination number. So in fact, if you can see, for I have marked with red whichever for which all those n's for which domination number is not equal to independent domination number. So for n equal to 4, it is not equal. For n equal to 6, it is not equal. Then for n equal to 12, it is not equal. And then for n equal to 18 also, it is not equal. For n equal to 19, domination number is known. It is equal to 10, but independent domination number, we don't know. We know only the fact that the independent domination number can either be equal to 10 or it can be equal to 11, but we are not sure that whether it is 10 or it is 11. Now, there is a lower bound in domination number. So this is a obvious lower bound. N minus 1 by 2 is always less than equal to the domination number, and it is less than equal to independent domination number. For n equal to 3 and 11, it has been proved that the domination number and independent domination number is equal to this bound. So this bound is sharp. For n, for all other n's, it has been proved that the domination number is greater than equal to the seal of n by 2. For all the other values, it has been proved that the domination number is greater than equal to the seal of n by 2. So it has been conjectured that the independent domination number lies between is smaller than n by 2 plus 1, seal of n by 2 plus 1. So if you can see from these two results, here we have, it has been proved that domination number is always greater than equal to the seal of n by 2. And here it has been conjectured that the independent domination number is less than equal to n by 2 plus 1. So basically, it means that the domination number and independent domination number can differ by at most 1, and they lie between the seal of n by 2 and n by 2 plus 1. And to support this conjecture, for n equal to 1 to 120, it has been proved that independent domination number of Coons graph is less than equal to the seal of n by 2 plus 1. Now, the two parameters, this domination number and independent domination number, they can be equal for infinitely many graphs. And to prove this fact, if you take any graph, if you take corona of any graph, then domination number of that corona graph will be equal to the independent domination number, and that will be equal to the cardinality of the graph G. So there are, for each graph, there is a graph corresponding to each graph, there is one graph. So there are infinitely many graphs for which the domination number is equal to independent domination number. Now, also, so here we have seen that the domination number can be equal for infinitely many graphs. And in this case, we see that we can make the domination number and the independent domination number, the difference between the two parameters, we can make them arbitrary large. So if we consider the double star, then the difference between the independent domination number and domination number is equal to minimum of ST minus 1. So if we increase our SNT, then the difference between the two will definitely increase. So we can make them as large as we want. So given any positive integer k, we can always find a graph such that the difference between the domination number and independent domination number is equal to k. So in general, we have seen that the domination number and independent domination number may or may not be equal. So this problem of characterizing graphs for which domination number and independent domination number is a long standing problem, and it has attracted a lot of researchers over the years. Many researchers have worked on this problem, and these are some of the research papers, some of the very important research papers on this problem. So this is the first paper is by Allen and Oscar. So they have proved in this paper, they have proved that every Clough-free graph satisfies this equality. Then in this paper also, there are some results which are for this equality of the two parameters. So all these papers are very important research papers for all those who want to pursue their research in characterizing graphs with domination number equal to independent domination number. So the characterization of trees satisfying this domination number equal to independent domination number was first given by Harari and Livingstone. But the characterization that they obtained was very complicated and was difficult to apply. So to obtain a much simpler characterization, Cocaine and others, they came up with another characterization of trees satisfying this equality. And to simplify this, they have analyzed the vertices that are present in all minimum dominating sets in the trees. So this is the result that they have proved. So given any tree, so they have taken any tree, and what they have done, they have collected this set 80. This represents the set of all vertices which are in every minimum dominating set. So they collect all the vertices that are present in every minimum dominating set, and then they pick any vertex that is not there in this set, that is a vertex which is not present in at least one minimum dominating set. So they pick any arbitrary vertex, and they construct another set which they have denoted by AVT. So what they do, they remove the neighborhood of V from this set. So they remove the neighborhood of V from this set. So they obtain this set. And now what they do, they iteratively define some trees. They iteratively define some trees with initial tree as the given tree. So first tree is this. So TV0 is the initial tree, which is the given tree. And then they iteratively define the tree. So how they have defined? So they take the previous tree and they remove the neighborhood of all the vertices in this tree. So this is how they iteratively define trees. Now, because our tree is finite, so after certain number of steps, after certain number of iterations, we get this set to be empty set. So this set becomes empty set. And at that step, the tree that we obtain after some number of iterations, so that we denoted by TV tilde. And then we define this set IT. And this is the set of all vertices that are present in all minimum dominating set of this trees. So we define this IT, which is the set of all vertices that are present in all minimum dominating set of this trees. So then they have proved that for any tree, the domination number of tree will be equal to its independent domination number if and only if this set AT, which is the set of all vertices that are present in every gamma set, is union this set IT, which is the set of all vertices that is present in all the gamma set of the last tree obtained in the iteration. So if this set is independent, then the domination number will be equal to the independent domination number of the tree. So the trees with the tree satisfying this gamma t equal to it are completely characterized, but the general problem of characterizing such graphs for which domination number is equal to independent domination number is still an open problem. And in this direction, in 1978, Allen Lasker, they proved that if a graph is a Clough-free graph, then it satisfies the equality. That is, if G is a graph which has no index subgraph isomorphic to the Clough K1-3, then its domination number will be equal to independent domination number. So this is our Clough K1-3. So let us denote the family of all Clough-free graphs by F1. So we denote the family F1, which is the family of all Clough-free graphs. Then in the year 1991, Top Walkman, they extended this Allen-Lasker theorem. They provided the 16 graphs. By providing 16 graphs, says that if a graph has no induced subgraph isomorphic to one of these 16 graphs, then it satisfies the equality of domination number equal to independent domination number. So if a graph G has no induced subgraph isomorphic to one of these 16 H1, H2, H16 graphs, then the domination number will be equal to independent domination number. And what they have done, so because in Allen-Lasker theorem they worked on only this vertex, but they do not consider this vertex. So in the proof there was another vertex that was coming, but because they were getting contradiction at a much earlier step, so they do not proceed further. So they stopped their proof, but then Top and Walkman, they extended this, they analyze this vertex, and then they observe that if we can remove this 16 graphs from the given graph, then the graph will be, this graph will satisfy gamma g equal to ig. So we denote by F2 the family of hi free graphs which were given by Top Walkman. So because every Clough free graph is an hi free graph, so these F1 is a subset of F2. So Top Walkman, they extended this Allen-Lasker theorem. Now we come to our contribution to this equality. So this is the research paper that we have published recently in 2020. So it is my joint work with my PhD supervisor, Professor Purnima Gupta. So she was my PhD supervisor, and with Professor S. Arumugam, you must be knowing his name. He is known as the father of graph theory in India. So this is the joint work with Professor Purnima Gupta and S. Arumugam. So we obtained a sufficient condition for a graph to satisfy gamma g equal to ig. And what was the important fact about this sufficient condition was that if we can obtain Allen-Lasker theorem and Top Walkman theorem as a corollary to this sufficient condition. In fact, and we also obtained several other classes of graphs where our sufficient condition was met, but we could not obtain the equality with this Allen-Lasker theorem or Top Walkman theorem. So in that way, our theorem was an extension of the theorem by Allen-Lasker and Top Walkman theorem. So we call a graph G to be gamma I graph if it satisfies the equality domination number equal to independent domination number. Then we used this private neighbors. So for any subset S of the vertex set V in a graph G and any vertex U belonging to S, a vertex V is called a private neighborhood of U with respect to S if NV intersection S is equal to U. So there is U is the only vertex adjacent to V in S. U is the only vertex in S which is adjacent to V. So that's why V is called the private neighborhood of U with respect to S. So if further this V is outside of S, then V is called an external private neighborhood of U with respect to S. And the set of all private neighbors of U with respect to S is denoted by PNUS, and the set of all external private neighbors of U with respect to S is denoted by EPNUS. So this definition is found in this the book that I have represented, that I have shown in one of my slides. So you can find this definition there also. So motivated from this definition of private neighbor, so we have introduced this external private neighbor of a set. So vertex, we have defined it for a set. So we define it like this. So external private neighborhood of set UV with respect to S is the set of all vertices that outside of V, outside of S, and it says that NW intersection S is contained in UV. So we have defined this set, and using this set, we obtained this sufficient condition for a graph G to satisfy gamma G equal to IG. So given any graph G, if there exists a gamma set D, says that for every gamma set D dash, so we take any every gamma set D dash with satisfying this condition, and for each pair of adjacent vertices UV in D dash, if the independent domination number of this induced subgraph EPN UVD dash is equal to 2, then the then domination number of that graph will be equal to its independent domination number. So if such a dominating set exists for which such that for every gamma set D dash which is satisfying this condition, and for any pair of vertices UV in D dash, if this condition is also satisfied, then for that graph, domination number will be equal to its independent domination number. So for example, if you look at this graph, so its domination number is equal to 3. So this is the dominating set U, V, and W5. So in this vertex, in this set D, only this pair of vertex are adjacent. So U and V are adjacent. And for this pair, EP and UV is equal to W1, W2, W3. So this is the external private neighbor of UV. So for this, the cardinality is 2. Its independent domination number comes out to be 2. You can easily find it. So by using our theorem, we can easily establish that its domination number will be equal to independent domination number. So as I have already said that our sufficient condition, with our sufficient condition, we can easily obtain this Allain-Lasker theorem and Topfhoffmann theorem. So this is the first theorem. So this is corollary. This Allain-Lasker theorem is a corollary to our theorem. So if a G, and then this theorem is also present in the literature, and this is also a corollary to our theorem. So if G is a graph in which the set of all vertices with degree greater than or equal to 3 is an independent set, then its domination number happens to be equal to its independent domination number. Then Topfhoffmann theorem is also a corollary to our theorem. To prove this fact, we have first proved this lemma. So we have proved that if a graph G contains no induced subgraph isomorphic to one of the 16 graphs that I have shown earlier, then for each gamma set D of G and for each pair of adjacent vertices U, V, and D, this condition is satisfied. So basically, it means that if a graph has no induced subgraph isomorphic to one of the 16 graphs, then our sufficient condition is satisfied. And because our sufficient condition is satisfied, so such graph will be equal to, so such graph will satisfy the equality domination number equal to independent domination number. So these are some of the graphs that satisfy our sufficient condition, but we cannot obtain the equality of the parameters gamma G equal to IG using Allain-Lasker and Topfhoffmann theorem. So G1, this graph G1, as you can see, has easily, you can see that it has K1, 3 and H1 as an induced subgraph. This G2 has K1, 3 and H1, H2 and H10 as an induced subgraph. This G3 has K1, 3, H1 and H2 as an induced subgraph. So thus, if we denote by F3 the family of graphs satisfying our sufficient condition, then the family F1, which is the family of trophy graphs, is properly contained in F2, which is the family of graphs having HI-free graphs, and then F3 is our family of graphs satisfying the sufficient condition given by us. So now we exhibit another class of gamma I graphs which belongs to F3, that is, which satisfy our sufficient condition, but they do not belong to both F1 or F2. And we have used the concept of generalized corona to define that family of graph. So if G is a graph of order P and H is obtained from G by taking its generalized corona with the complete graphs, then gamma H is equal to IH and that comes out to be equal to the cardinality of the graph G. So this is the generalized corona of C4 with complete graph. So this is K2 here, then we have K3, this is K2 and K4. So C4, corona K4, K3, K2 and K2. So now we have obtained another graph, another family of graphs which are in F3 but not in F1 and F2. So we have used the concept of duplicating of an edge, which was defined by Vaidya and Pandit, and when they obtained this some results on graphs with equal domination and independent domination number. So they have also worked on this parameter. So they defined this duplication of an edge as a in the operation. So a graph H obtained from G by duplicating an edge E equal to UV by a vertex. It means the graph H, which is obtained from G by adding a vertex W, such that the neighborhood of W in H is equal to UV. So what we do is we add a vertex W and we make it adjacent to U and V. So this is what it means by duplicating an edge by a vertex. So we put a vertex corresponding to an edge and we make both the end vertex of that edge adjacent to the new vertex W. So this is the duplication of an edge by a vertex. And if H is a graph obtained from a graph G by duplicating each edge of G by a new vertex, then it is easy to see that H is a graph with vertex set. So such graph, so if you can, we are duplicating each edge of the graph. So we are obtaining a graph H from G by duplicating each edge of the graph by a new vertex. So corresponding to each edge, we are putting a vertex and we are making that vertex adjacent to the end vertices of that edge. So it is easy to see that such a graph can also be looked upon as that H is the graph with vertex set VSG. SG is the subdivision of the graph G. So you subdivide each edge of the graph exactly once, and then you take the vertex set. So that is the vertex set of the set H, and H set is, so you combine the edge set of this subdivision graph and the original graph. So then the graph that you obtain is the graph which is obtained by duplicating each edge of the graph G by a new vertex. So for any graph G, the graph with vertex set VSG is called duplicated subdivision graph of G, which I have explained just now. So then we have proved that if G is a bipartite graph with bipartition XY such that the cardinality of X is smaller than the cardinality of Y, so X is the smaller set in the bipartition, and if there exists a matching M in G such that M saturates all the vertices of X, then the domination number of the duplicated subdivision graph of G will be equal to the independent domination number of the duplicated subdivision graph of G, and that will be equal to the cardinality of the smallest set in the bipartition X. So now the result from Vaidya and others in this paper is a corollary to this theorem. So they have proved that for the complete, so they have taken the duplicated subdivision graph of complete bipartite graph, and we have taken any arbitrary bipartite graph. Also, this results, if G is a one factorable bipartite graph, then the domination number of the duplicated subdivision graph of G will be equal to the independent domination number of the duplicated subdivision graph of G, and which will be equal to the cardinality of G divided by 2. And then the next corollary, this corollary is due to the famous result that every regular bipartite graph admits a perfect matching. Every regular bipartite graph admits a perfect matching. So then we were able to obtain this result that if G is a regular bipartite graph with bipartition X pi, then the domination number of the duplicated subdivision graph of G is equal to the independent domination number of the duplicated subdivision graph of G, and which is equal to the cardinality of the half of the cardinality of the graph G. So then the Vaidya and Pandit, they have defined another operation on the graph. So they have duplicated a vertex y and edge. Earlier we did a duplication of an edge by a vertex. In this we have a duplication of a vertex by an edge. So if a graph edge obtained from G by duplicating a vertex W by a new edge in a graph, means the graph edge obtained from by adding an edge E, such that NHU is equal to WB and NHV is equal to WU. So what we do is, corresponding to a vertex, we add an edge and then we join the two end vertices of the edge by the vertex. So corresponding to W, basically we add two adjacent vertices U and V, and then we join U and V with W. So this with this definition, we define duplication of a vertex by a click. So this is the definition. So instead of taking an edge, we are taking a click. Instead of, so you can consider this edge to be a K2. So instead of K2, we are taking any click KN. So this is how we have defined. So we are adding our click corresponding to a vertex, and we are making every vertex of that click adjacent to W. So then we have proved this theorem that if G is a bipartite graph and H is the graph obtained by duplicating each edge by a new vertex, and as well as we are duplicating each edge by a vertex, and we are duplicating each vertex by a click. So corresponding to each edge, we are adding a vertex, and corresponding to each vertex, we are adding a click. And the graph that we obtain is that graph satisfies this equality. Domination number is equal to independent domination number. So these are the corollaries then. So this result is proved by Vaidya and Pandit, and it happens to be a corollary to our theorem, this theorem. So they have proved that if G is a graph obtained from, so they are taking a complete bipartite graph and they are taking the generalized corona, and then they are duplicating each edge of this by K1. So instead of click, they are taking the K1. Then its domination number equals to independent domination number. And similarly it can be proved that if G is a graph which is obtained by duplication of each edge of the cycle by a new vertex and duplication of each vertex of the cycle by a click, then its domination number is equal to n, and its independent domination number is equal to n if n is even, and n plus 1 if n is odd. So for even cycles, the domination number equals to independent domination number. So these are some of my references. So first paper, this is by Aaron and Lasker. So in this paper it has been proved that every Clough-Free graph satisfies the equality gamma g equal to ig. Then this is the paper by Top and Walkman. So they introduced the 16 graphs h1 h2 h16, says that if a graph is has no inducer graph isomorphic to such graphs, then they satisfy the equality domination number equal to independent domination number. Then this is in this paper also, there is some results on graphs with domination number equal to independent domination number. Then this is a survey paper of independent domination in graphs. So it mentions few results on domination and independent domination number that are present in the literature. Thank you. Any questions from the audience?
Dear participants, any question you may ask?
Is there any algorithm to analyze the equality of domination and independent domination members, sir?
There has been some work done on this, but as such, there is no algorithm.
Okay, thank you, sir.
But it will be a very good problem to define some algorithm, but it is an NP hard problem, so it will take good work.
Yes, yes, yes. Thank you.
Any other questions?
Dr. Rajesh?
Yes, yes, ma'am.
You presented 18 graphs in the top Walkman theorem.
Yes, ma'am. 16 graphs.
Yes, 16, sorry. So 16 graphs and if a graph does not contain any of the graphs.
Yes, ma'am. Let me show you that.
That is equal to the independent domination number.
Yes, ma'am.
Can you explain what is the fundamental thing behind these graphs? Yes. If these are not present, then domination number becomes independent domination number.
So that is what we have used in our theorem, that in all such graphs, because we take any pair of adjacent vertices, then we always get the independent domination number equal to 2. So instead of considering the whole graph, we can consider the pair of vertices and we can look for their independent domination number. That's what we have done in this our sufficient condition.
Can you please explain? So because there was a call.
So if you can see in each of these graphs, we have two vertices, and we can always find a vertex that dominates, such that the independent domination number of that is. In this case, if you can see this, what you cannot find any two vertices, which are dominating the other vertices, independent set in all these graphs. So that's why if you remove these graphs, then it happens to be in such graphs, the domination number comes out to be equal to independent domination number. So instead of considering the whole graph, we can consider the graphs, we can consider two pair of vertices, or we can examine each pair of vertices. So to define our algorithm, it can be easier if we consider pair of vertices in each step.
In light of this, so do you have like some other graph, like now we have like closely graph and these 16 graphs, and based on this fundamental, maybe we can find some other graph which suffices, whose absence suffices.
No,
we can say that
it is not possible. It is not possible to obtain the complete characterization in terms of this. What you call forbidden subgraphs, because if I take any graph and if I add a vertex adjacent to all the vertices of that graph, then that graph, for that graph, domination number equals independent domination number, and which is equal to 1 because we have added a vertex of full degree. But so any graph we can take as an induced subgraph, and then we always have a graph which satisfies the equality. So we can never obtain a characterization with forbidden structures. But yes, definitely we can add some more structures to this 16 graphs. Definitely that can be done. But we cannot obtain the complete characterization.
In terms of forbidden, you are saying?
Yes, in terms of forbidden, we cannot obtain the complete characterization, because we can take any graph as any graph, and then we can add a vertex which is adjacent to all the vertices. So then the new graph that we obtain, it satisfies the equality, and it has, so we can take, we can make any subgraph as an induced subgraph of a graph which is satisfying the equality. So we cannot obtain the complete characterization in that case.
Looking at the first graph, so that's the only one which could be present in a tree. if you look at the first
graph. Yes. All the other subgraphs have a cycle.
They are not like. So that means, if a tree, you can easily say that there is a tree, why don't you deduce from the first graph that if a tree is such that no two adjacent vertices have two pendants each in this case. So we can immediately conclude that as a corollary. Whenever there are two adjacent vertices, so at the most one pendant at it.
But
like from the first graph. So we can easily conclude
I'm
that.
Not sure. Yes, we can, in case of trees, that if a tree has no induced subgraph isomorphic to this H1, then it is definitely the domination number is equal to independent domination number. But other way around, we don't know.
It's a sufficient condition.
Yes, it is a sufficient condition.
It's a sufficient. So it's a very good, like for a tree, if there are two adjacent vertices and something like this is not there,
definitely.
It should be highlighted.
Yes.
Thank you, madam. Any other participants?
Hello, sir. Nice presentation. I have a question, sir.
Yes, sir.
This is Veera Sivaji.
Yes, sir.
I repeat same question, sir. Actually, the condition I have independent number is equal to dominating number, right? Any other graph it is suitable for the same result?
Any other graph.
Result is same.
Yes, I have shown some examples also.
Okay, sir.
Let me show you my slide again. So, this is one example in which domination number is equal to independent domination number. And then we have shown these three examples. So in this graph, G1 is also domination number is equal to independent domination number, but they are not. Okay. You cannot obtain the equality using Allen-Lasker theorem and Tok-Bruckmann theorem, but it satisfies our sufficient condition. So domination number is equal to independent domination number in this graph.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Okay, thank you, sir.
Okay, so I would also like to thank the organizers once again for giving me this opportunity to deliver the lecture on this platform. So thank you.
Thank you, sir.